Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Telepsychics, Tapping Your Hidden Subconscious Powers by Joseph Murphy, Ph.D. Narrated by Timothy Andres Pabon. What this book can do for you. Everyone possesses the power of telepsychics, which means constant communication with the various and marvelous powers of your mind. Wherever I go, whether Europe, Asia, Africa, Australia, or the various cities in our own country, people tell me of the amazing untapped powers that they have contacted and that have completely transformed their lives. This audiobook is extremely practical and down to earth. It is intended for all those who wish to experience the riches of the mind to bring them the objects of their desires and needs. You can get immediate results by using the laws of your subconscious mind in the right way. You will find simple, practical techniques and easy-to-do programs in every chapter of this book, enabling you to put into practice the act of leading a full and happy life. Telepsychics teaches you how to meet and overcome the challenges, difficulties, trials, and other problems of daily living. It supplies you with special techniques for putting the extraordinary powers within you into operation at once. The unique features of this book. You will learn how to visualize future events, and if they appear to be negative in nature, to change them through the application of metaphysical powers. You will learn how to develop your intuitive and other psychic powers, which will set you on the high road to freedom and peace of mind. You will learn the superstitious origins of black and white magic, and how to neutralize and reject the so-called voodoo curse and all other negative suggestions that may be adversely affecting you. In this audiobook, you will also learn to use powers of extrasensory and psychic perception. You can communicate with so-called dead people and determine whether or not a loved one has actually spoken to you. Many people converse at length with voices of discarnate entities or disembodied spirits and receive extraordinarily intelligent answers. You will learn how a sensitive or psychic person practices automatic writing without using a pen or pencil and reveals future events with amazing accuracy. In writing the many chapters of the book that became this audiobook, I had in mind the salesman, the stenographer, the mailman, the housewife, the businessman, the clerk behind the counter, the student, the professional man, and all those who wish to fulfill their dreams, aspirations, and ambitions in life. Therefore, you will find each chapter pregnant with simple, intensely practical techniques, the what to do and how to do it, for calling forth the powers of your psychic mind, knowing that there is an infinite intelligence in your subconscious mind that knows only the true answer. Some of the highlights of this audiobook. Following are some of the actual case histories in this audiobook that demonstrate how others have benefited from using their telepsychic powers. How a college student who was failing in his studies suddenly realized that the infinite cannot fail, and how tuning in with the infinite, he became a brilliant success. How in a dream, a young nurse saw the skyjacking of the plane on which she had planned to travel. She canceled her trip, and the plane was subsequently skyjacked. How a sales manager focused his attention on a blank wall and then projected onto the wall a mental picture of the annual sales figures that he desired to achieve. He got marvelous results. How a woman overcame her fear of four people who she said were praying for her downfall. She joined up with the one power and is now at peace. How a woman in Hawaii learned to laugh at so-called black magic and voodoo curses. She discovered the power within her and said, "I am now free." How a university student who was praying for a husband saw her future husband in a dream with a book under his arm. She met him 2 months later and married him. how telepsychics enabled a detective to discover large supplies of cocaine and heroin. All this was revealed to him in a dream. The value of the narcotics was $3 million. How a wife used telepsychics and saved her husband's life. A man fired 3 shots at him, all of which missed him as a result of his wife's protective prayer. How telepsychics saved his life in a dream. In his dream, he read the headlines in a newspaper which told him of the loss of 92 passengers. He canceled his flight, and the accident that was foreseen in his dream actually occurred. How telepsychics saved the lives of a mother and son who were being slowly asphyxiated by the leakage of a gas jet. Her deceased husband appeared to her and told her to turn off the gas. How telepsychics revealed a lost diamond. In a dream, she saw her ring clearly in the maid's room, wrapped in a piece of paper and located in an old shoe belonging to the maid. How telepsychics acts as an invisible partner and guide to a businessman who frequently invests up to $1 million in bonds. His investments are always very profitable. How a simple explanation of telepsychics saved the life of a would-be suicide. How a man's knowledge of telepsychics saved his life on a burning airplane. How a young businessman practiced telepsychics and made a small fortune in gold stock. A man appeared to him in a dream and gave him the names of gold stocks to purchase. He followed the instructions and became financially successful. How telepsychics revealed the whereabouts of a lost deed to a young secretary whose father had died, leaving no records. How telepsychics revealed hidden talents to a teacher in a dream, fulfilling her heart's desire for full expression and accumulation of wealth. How telepsychics revealed to a girl whose father had died the whereabouts of hidden family money. Her father appeared to her in a dream and showed her where a steel box containing $13,000 was located. How telepsychics enabled a young man to become an airline pilot. There were 2,500 applicants for 10 openings. 90% of them had more experience than this young man. He pictured himself working as a pilot, and he succeeded in getting the position. How telepsychics gave the numbers to play on the roulette wheel to a man in his sleep. The next day, he won $50,000. How telepsychics revealed to a young girl the whereabouts of an old earthenware jug. Her father dug up the backyard and found the jug, which was full of valuable coins dating back to 1898. Telepsychics is a simple, practical, logical, and scientific method that works to fulfill your deepest desires. I want to say positively, definitely, unquestionably and decisively, that by using the instructions in this audiobook, you will reap the fruits of a rich, happy, joyous, and successful life. Let wonders happen to you by following the guidance of this audiobook and by applying it in your daily life. Dr. Joseph Murphy. Chapter 1. How telepsychics can be your magic power for perfect living. Magic is referred to as the art of producing a desired effect or result through the use of various techniques. Men speak of the magic of music, the magic of spring, and the magic of beauty. It is also referred to as the art of causing illusions, such as in entertainment by the use of sleight of hand, legerdemain, and conjuring, whereby one pulls a rabbit out of a hat or causes a human being to disappear. The invisible power within you. To most people, magic is the production of effects by unknown forces. Magic, however, is a relative term. Obviously, if the processes are known to you, the work is not a work of magic to you. In many remote places in the world today, among primitive people, the airline radio, television, or recording machines would be considered magical objects. Likewise, these discoveries would have been looked upon as magical 150 or 200 years ago in our own country. We understand how astronauts managed to go to the moon today and do not therefore call it magical. All forces are in their nature unknown, all things come forth from spirit. We do not see spirit, but we can feel the spirit of joy, the spirit of the game, the spirit of the musician, the spirit of the speaker, and the spirit of goodness, truth, and beauty, moving through our minds and hearts. No theologian has ever seen spirit, God, but we can use this presence and power in all phases of our lives. We don't know what electricity is, for instance. We only know about some of the things it does. The force itself is still unknown to us. Actually, all of us practice magic constantly. We desire to lift our finger, and lo and behold, the invisible power responds according to the intention of our mind. Yet we do not know exactly how we move and lift our finger. Socrates informs us that just by lifting a finger, you disturb the most distant star. You will perceive that we all are familiar enough with the magic power within us, though it is not called by that name in our workaday world. Tuning in with the magic power. You can tune in to the infinite power within you and transform your whole life. Wherever I go, whether to Europe, Asia, Africa, Australia, or the various cities in our own country, people tell me of the amazing, untapped power which they have contacted and which has completely transformed their lives. Many of them have said that their old friends and acquaintances have remarked to them, "What's happened to you? I hardly know you." As you follow the techniques and processes outlined in this audiobook, you will find out that this inner power can solve your problems, prosper you, reveal hidden talents to you, and lift you up from sickness, failure, lack, and limitations of all kinds. This power can guide you and open up new doors of expression for you. You can receive inspiration, guidance, and new creative ideas, bringing you harmony, happiness, and peace of mind. How a college student tuned in for passing examinations. A few months ago, I talked with a college student who was getting rather poor grades. He was quite despondent because his marks were, as he said, bad enough to cause him to flunk out. He had been reading and studying Secrets of the I Ching, and in asking it a question, it said, "Go and see the great man." He interpreted that to mean that he should see a counselor or spiritual advisor, though it had deeper meanings also. I asked, "Why do you want poor grades? Infinite intelligence is within your subconscious mind, and you can use it." "Okay," he said. "My parents criticize me and point out that my sister is a much better student than I am and passes all her examinations easily." I explained to this young man that he should immediately cease comparing himself with his sister, because all comparisons are odious, pointing out that each person is unique and that everyone is born with different endowments. In comparing yourself with others, you are placing the other on a pedestal and denigrating yourself. Furthermore, you are giving too much attention to the activities and successes of your sister and neglecting your own studies while forgetting your own inner capacities and abilities. To continue along this line will cause you to lose initiative and incentive, causing a buildup of inner tension and anxiety. The only competition is in your own mind between the thought of failure and the thought of success. You were born to win, to triumph, to succeed, and to overcome all problems. The infinite power can't fail, and you are one with it. At my suggestion, he followed a simple and very practical technique, which he went over mentally every night prior to retiring, as follows. "I sincerely wish for my sister and all other students in my classes success and accomplishment in all their studies. Infinite intelligence guides me in my studies and reveals to me everything I need to know. I know my subconscious mind has a perfect memory and reveals to me the answers on all my examinations. I pass all my examinations in divine order. I sleep in peace every night, and I awake in joy. As he continued thinking and acting these lines, a few weeks ago he said to me, "I'm competing with no one. I'm doing fine. I know now that I have what it takes." As Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, "There is guidance for each of us, and by slowly listening, we shall hear the right word." How she practiced telepsychics. Tele means communication, and psyche means the soul or spirit within you. When you pray, you are contacting your psyche, or higher self, and it responds according to your belief and recognition of it. A young nurse recently planned on taking a flight, but the night before the departure, she had a vivid experience. In a dream, she saw the plane hijacked, and an inner voice spoke to her and said, "Cancel your trip." She awakened startled, but she followed the inner instruction and canceled the flight. Incidentally, the plane she had selected was hijacked. The guiding principle of her subconscious caused her to see the event before it happened in order to protect her. The plan to hijack the plane was already in the universal subconscious mind, and as she prayed for guidance, she received the answer in a dream which came from her deeper mind. Her prayer before retiring every night is as follows. "Divine love goes before me wherever I go, making joyous, happy, and glorious my way. The sacred circle of God's eternal love surrounds me, and I am always watched over by God. I bear a charmed life." This prayer is true telepsychics, or actual communication with the infinite intelligence of her subconscious mind, which knows all, sees all, and responds to the nature of her thought. Action and reaction are cosmic and universal. In prayer, you are having a dialogue with your higher self, which some call God. Others use the term true self, living spirit almighty, the Father within, infinite intelligence, the Oversoul, Brahma, Allah, etc. There are many names for the power within you, but in any case, it is timeless, spaceless, ageless, and nameless. The Bible calls it I Am, which means being, life, awareness, self-originating spirit, unconditioned consciousness. All you need to remember is that your thought causes the infinite power to respond. You are dealing with a reciprocal action and reaction. As you sow, you reap, and as you call, you receive an answer. He discovered the power of his mental image. Thoreau said years ago that we become what we image. The mental picture you hold in your mind tends to manifest itself in your experience. A sales manager who often attends my lectures at the Wilshire Ebel Theater on Sunday mornings told me how he draws on the power of his imagination, which he finds extraordinarily effective. Here it is. He relaxes and calms his mind by quietly repeating to himself the 23rd Psalm. Then he looks at the white wall in his office. As he focuses his attention on the blank white wall, he throws a picture of the sales figures he wants at the end of the year. He looks at the amount closely, focusing all his attention on the financial figures. Then he claims these figures are now sinking down into his subconscious mind. Finally, he hears the president of the company congratulating him on the wonderful growth of the organization and his splendid accomplishments. He said that he knew when the figures had reached his subconscious because the impression was always followed by a sense of great peace. This is truly telepsychics in action. His mental image was communicated to his psyche, subconscious mind, and was developed in the dark room of his mind, coming forth as the joy of the answered prayer. This sales manager said that for the past 4 years, the financial sales figures for each of the years has always exceeded his mental image. This is true because your subconscious always magnifies whatever is impressed upon it. give the right mental image to your subconscious. Every picture that you create in your mind, particularly when emotionalized, comes to pass. It works out in action, either internally or externally. If you inhibit it from working out an external action, it is inevitable that it will work out in internal action in some mental, emotional, or physical disturbance of your body. Be careful that you do not indulge in mental images that you don't want to carry out in external actions. I once knew an alcoholic who was imprisoned for manslaughter. He said to me that he was absolutely determined never to imbibe again when he was discharged from prison. The very day he was released, however, he immediately began to drink heavily. Why? The simple reason is because he was always forming mental pictures of a drink while he was in prison, and the moment he got out, he took to the bottle. He externalized the act of that which he was picturing all the time. If he had not externalized his mental image, this picture would have hurt him in some other way, probably in the form of physical or emotional upset. Thus, every picture that you create in your mind has to be worked into action, lest it manifest itself in some mental, physical, or emotional disharmony in the body. How a writer discovered the magic power within him. A writer friend of mine told me that he had a misunderstanding with the producer of a play based on his script. They had a rather heated exchange. He had read Miracle of Mind Dynamics and had applied many of the techniques of prayer outlined therein. When he went home, he went into his den, relaxed and thought about the infinite power within him. Then he conducted an imaginary conversation with the producer as if he were experiencing the future now. He pictured the producer right in front of him, claiming harmony, peace, and perfect understanding between them. In his vivid imagination, he conversed with the producer, saying that all he wanted was divine right action. He imagined the producer responding, saying, "There is perfect agreement between us. Divine right action prevails." In this quiet, passive state, he envisioned a happy ending, feeling the imaginary handshake of the producer and the perfect, harmonious solution. Several days passed, and the writer met the producer in the club to which they belonged. Before he had a chance to greet him, the producer called him over and said, "I have reread your script, and I admit you were right. What is right action for one is right action for all concerned." What the writer had claimed to be true subjectively came to pass objectively. Try it. It works. There isn't a single human being in the country that cannot overcome fear, anger, and hostility and resolve his conflicts, sharpen his mind, and live an amazing life. We go about it by changing our attitudes like the writer I've been talking about. William James, the great American psychologist, said, "Human beings can alter their lives by altering their attitudes of mind." Telepsychics is for all men and women. Inspiration, or contact with the infinite power, can come to you as easily as the air you breathe. You breathe casually and without effort. Likewise, we let the divine intelligence or creative essence of God into our minds or intellect without tension. Many people have erroneous ideas about inspiration. They believe it is an extraordinary experience given or had by mystics or other highly spiritual people. This is not so. Although it is true that people who lead spiritual lives may be inspired frequently or get spontaneous feelings or ideas, it is equally true that the businessman may also become inspired by turning to the infinite power within him. Inspiration, or divine guidance, may be had on any problem. In other words, the information you seek, knowledge required, or business difficulty solved may be achieved simply by asking God or the infinite power for the answer. You may be a novelist and have several books to your credit, yet when you get a pad and a pencil or typewriter, you can't begin. Nothing happens, not an idea, plot, or story. You may drink 6 cups of coffee and it does not help. Quiet your mind, however, and claim that you are inspired from on high and that God's creative ideas unfold within you in divine order, you will then receive knowledge, guidance, and creative energy. Ideas will flow to you freely, joyously, and lovingly. An engineer gets specific data. An engineer once told me that he wanted specific data for an engineering examination. He realized that his professor had given him the information, but he had forgotten it. He asked his subconscious mind to furnish him with the answer and then went to work on other parts of the examination, and the answer welled up from his deeper mind. It was in his subconscious mind all the time, and when he relaxed and let go, the wisdom of his subconscious came freely into his conscious mind, and he passed his examination easily. Remember, the quiet mind receives the answer. The Cash Register Man. Some years ago, I read a magazine article about the man who got the idea for the cash register. The article explained that although the man had not had much of an education, he was very intelligent and perceptive. Once, while on an ocean voyage, he asked the ship's officer to explain to him the workings of the log, which registered the speed of the ship. The explanation was given, and suddenly, the man got the idea for the cash register. This man was aware of a specific problem. Men are often wrongfully accused of stealing, while others steal and never get caught. Also, when cash is exchanged, countless errors can be made in change. He immediately related the workings of the ship's log to a solution to this problem, and through this inspiration, he developed the cash register. This was inspiration, or telepsychics. Ask your subconscious to give you creative ideas, and a similar idea worth a fortune may well up within you. How to practice telepsychics every day. You can tune in with your higher self and receive answers by calming yourself and knowing that when you call, there will be a response in accordance with the nature of your call. Recall that the wire from the powerhouse is placed in your room or cellar. The main wire belongs to Edison, the wiring in the house belongs to you, and the contact is there enabling you to turn on the light. Similarly, your conscious mind can, at this moment, contact the infinite storehouse and wisdom within you. You would not pray unless you believed that there is a wisdom and intelligence in your subconscious which knows all and sees all and is responsive to your call. The Bible says, "Before they call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear." Isaiah chapter 65, verse 24. Points to remember. 1. Telepsychics means communication with your psyche or soul, that is, your subconscious mind, which is coextensive with all wisdom and all power. When you pray believing, your subconscious mind responds with the answer. 2. Magic is a relative term. To most people, magic is the production of effects by unknown forces. All forces are, in their essence, unknown. Scientists do not know what energy is. Edison, when asked by a woman what electricity was, replied, "Madam, it is. Use it." There is an invisible wisdom, power, and intelligence in your subconscious mind which knows all and sees all. You can contact this power with your conscious mind. This primal power is timeless, ageless, nameless, and eternal. 3. You can use your inner powers to solve your problems, prosper you along all lines, reveal your hidden talents, and set you on the high road to happiness, peace of mind, and freedom. 4. Cease comparing yourself with others. This attitude consists in denigrating yourself while placing others on a pedestal. You are unique, different from every person in the world. Give attention to your inner powers, and you will excel in your chosen field. If you wish to pass an examination, don't compare yourself with other students. This attitude causes tension and anxiety. Relax, quiet your mind, and every morning and night affirm, feelingly and knowingly, "Infinite intelligence in my subconscious mind guides me in all my studies, and I will pass all examinations in divine order. 5. When you pray, you are actually contacting your higher self, which some call God or Supreme Intelligence. You get an answer according to your belief. Sometimes you may receive an answer in a dream that warns you not to take a certain trip. One young lady who prayed regularly for guidance, divine love, and right action dreamed 24 hours in advance of the hijacking of the plane on which she had arranged to travel. As a result, she canceled the trip. The reason for this is simple. The plan of the hijacking was already known in the collective subconscious, and her own subconscious, which is one with the collective mind, revealed the plan to her. 6. The picture you have in your mind tends to manifest itself in your life. A sales manager focuses his attention on a certain financial figure for the end of the year, and by repetition and concentration, this mental picture enters his subconscious mind. In the past 4 years, his subconscious has magnified and multiplied the desired result. The subconscious magnifies whatever you give attention to. 7. An ex-alcoholic who pictures himself drinking will be compelled to drink. Any mental picture you emotionalize will come to pass in your experience. Imagine what is lovely and of good report. 8. If you have a misunderstanding with another person, conduct an imaginary conversation with him based on the golden rule and the law of love, realizing that there is harmony, peace, and divine understanding between you. Imagine and picture in your mind the happy ending by shaking hands in harmony and peace. What you imagine and feel to be true subjectively will come to pass objectively. The Bible says, "I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe." John chapter 14, verse 29. Chapter 2. How Telepsychics Reveals the Great Secret of the Ages. Many people today are afraid of malignant thought projections, black magic, the evil eye, voodoo, etc. There seems to be a general fear that there is some sort of hidden power that others can use to hurt them or to mar their happiness. The greatest secret within man. You will truly lead a full and happy life when you awaken to the greatest of all truths. It is expressed in Deuteronomy, chapter 6, verse 4. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord," which means, "Hear, understand, O Israel, illumined, awakened man. The Lord, the lordly power or supreme power, our God, our ruler, the infinite power, is one Lord, one power, not two, not three, not ten, not 1,000, just one." The superstitious origin of black and white magic. When we were very young and highly impressionable, our parents, who didn't know any better, told us about a punitive God and also about a devil who would tempt us. They also cautioned us that if we were very bad, we might go to hell and suffer forever. Children and childish minds think only in pictures or mental images, and not knowing anything better, they project images of God and a devil. Children envision God up in the heavens on a golden throne, surrounded by angels, and the devil down below in the flames of hell, not realizing that in fact, all of us create our own heaven and our own hell by the ways in which we think, feel, and believe. Primitive man attributed pleasure to the gods and all pain, suffering, and misery to evil spirits or to devils of his own creation. Prehistoric man realized that he was subjected to strange forces over which he seemed to have no control. Earthquakes and floods took place, and not knowing the cause, the jungle priests said that the gods were angry. Then they proceeded to offer up sacrifices to appease the angry wrath of the supposed gods. The sun gave man heat, but in a prolonged drought, the same sun seemed to scorch the earth. Fire warmed man, but it also burned him. The thunder terrified him. Lightning paralyzed him with fear. The waters flooded his lands. At times, his cattle and children were drowned. His understanding of external powers consisted of primitive and fundamental beliefs in many types of gods. From this crude and ignorant reasoning, primitive man proceeded to supplicate the intelligences of the winds, the stars, and the waters, hoping they would hear him and answer his prayer. He proceeded to make offerings and sacrifices to the gods of the wind and the rain. Primitive man divided the gods and Genji into beneficial and malignant powers. Hence, you will find the universality of these two powers in all the creedal beliefs of millions of people. A belief in two powers is a hangover from these age-old superstitious beliefs. Good and evil in your life are determined by your thought. The forces of nature are not evil. It depends upon how you use them. You can use any power in either of two ways. The same wind will blow a boat on the rocks or carry it safely to the harbor. You can use electricity to fry an egg or to electrocute someone. You can use atomic energy constructively to drive a ship across the ocean or to destroy cities, towns, and people. You can use water to drown a child or quench his thirst, fire to warm or burn him. We give purpose to the forces of nature. Good and evil are in the mind of the individual. They are nowhere else. Think good, and good follows. Think evil, and evil follows. Keep your eyes on the greatest thought and move ahead in life. Judge Thomas Troward, author of Edinburgh Lectures and many other books, stated in 1902, "Once you admit that there is any power outside yourself, however beneficial you may conceive it to be, you have sown the seed which must sooner or later bear the fruit of fear, which is the entire ruin of life, love, and liberty. We must contend earnestly, both within ourselves and outwardly, for the one great foundation, and never, now unto all eternity, admit for a single instant any thought which is opposed to this, the basic truth of being." Troward has stated a marvelous truth, which each person should keep before him. The suggestions of others have no power to create the things they suggest. The power is in your own thought. When your thoughts are God's thoughts, God's power is with your thoughts of good. It is always the movement of your own thought which creates. You have the power to completely reject any negative suggestion and unite mentally with the omnipotence within you. Why the so-called voodoo curse is merely a negative suggestion. Some years ago, I visited Cape Town, South Africa, to lecture for the late Dr. Hester Brandt, who had a large center there teaching the science of the mind. While I was there, she arranged for me to visit one of the gold mines in Johannesburg. An English physician affiliated with one of the mines I visited told me that when a man who is working in the mine violates company code, he gets a message from the voodoo doctor such as, "You will die at 6 p.m., and he sits down and dies. Post-mortem examinations show no reasons for the death whatever, and the doctor added that fear, generated by the violators themselves, is the actual cause of death. She was terrified because they were praying against her. A few weeks ago, I talked to a young woman who was in great distress because she said there were some people in her former church praying against her because she had left their group. She believed that she was cursed and that as a result, everything was going wrong. I explained to her that the curse she mentioned was really the negative use of the law of her subconscious mind within herself, and that she was imposing the curses on herself through fear. The suggestions of others had become a movement of her own thoughts, And since her thoughts were creative, she was hurting herself. She was transferring the power within herself to members of her former church, not realizing that they had no power. I explained to her that the power was within her, and that she should immediately cease transmitting the power to others. God, or Spirit, is one and indivisible. It moves as unity. There are no divisions or quarrels in it, and as she aligned herself with the Infinite and gave it her allegiance, devotion, and loyalty, nothing would happen to her. She began to affirm, "I dwell in the secret place of the Most High, and I abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in Him will I trust." Psalm chapter 91, verse 2. I added, "Look at those people as extremely ignorant and have compassion on them. The real and ultimate power is the great affirmative, which is constructive. They are using suggestion, which is a power but not the power, God, which moves as harmony, beauty, love, and peace. Remember, a suggestion has no power unless you give it power. Join up consciously with the infinite love, life, and power within you, and constantly realize, God's love surrounds me, enfolds me, and enwraps me. I bear a charmed life. The spell of God envelops my whole being. Whenever I think of the church people, I will immediately affirm, I lose you to God and let you go." Practicing these simple truths, she was at peace, and she actually laughed at herself for giving her adversaries power. After about a week or so, she heard that five of these women became extremely ill and that one had passed on. This young woman no longer received their negative thoughts and vibrations, and their evil thoughts returned with double force to themselves. This is called the boomerang. She believed her father used black magic. Some months ago, I listened to the story of a woman in Honolulu who said that she had married outside her race and religion, and that since her father was a kahuna, native priest, and had magical powers, he was determined through sorcery to break up her marriage. The explanation is oftentimes the cure. This woman was a graduate of the University of Hawaii and had majored in psychology, yet she lived in fear of her father's curse. I elaborated along these lines, explaining that if love united herself and her husband, no person or condition could break her marriage up. God is love, and when two hearts beat as one, all the excommunications and curses of the world would be as papier-mâché aimed at a British battleship. The susceptibility to impressions of our subconscious mind, coupled with the negative use of our imagination, has partially paralyzed millions of unknowing people. This woman was laboring under the delusion that her father's sorcery, negative use of mind, was potent and would succeed. I told her the story of Plotinus, who lived over 1,700 years ago. An Egyptian priest visited Plotinus, one of the great illumined men of his age. The priest imposed a curse on Plotinus, that is, he mentally concentrated on a death wish for Plotinus and aimed it mentally at him. Plotinus knew the trick, and also knew that the foolish priest thought he had power. There is no power in a negative suggestion or a curse hurled at you by any or all the priests in the world, unless you are foolish and ignorant enough to accept it. Plotinus sensed his oneness with a God of love. God is omnipotent. One with God is a majority. If God be for us, who can be against us? Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. Luke chapter 10, verse 19. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. Psalm chapter 91, verse 10. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Psalm chapter 23, verse 4. It is recorded that the curse recoiled, and finding no place in Plotinus, boomeranged on the Egyptian priest who had tried to impose it. He fell into a fit and collapsed at the feet of Plotinus. Plotinus had pity on the priest's ignorance and took him by the hand and raised him up. This priest recognized the one power and became a devoted disciple of Plotinus. This explanation took a great load off the mind of this Hawaiian woman. She said to her father, "Dad, I am no longer afraid of you. You are to be pitied. You think you have power, but all you are using are negative suggestions, and what you suggest or wish for another, you are creating in your own experience. The power is within me, and I know my oneness with God. His love surrounds us and watches over us. Whenever I think of you, I affirm, God is for me. No one can be against me. I am free." She blessed her father, loosed him, and let him go. Shortly afterwards, she wrote me saying that her father continued to hate her and her husband and had written her that his sorcery or black magic would destroy both of them. She paid no attention to his threats, and in a few weeks, he dropped dead on the street. She said that her father had killed himself with hatred, and she was right. Hatred, jealousy, and hostility kill love, peace, harmony, joy, vitality, and goodwill. All his negative, destructive thoughts recoiled on himself, and the double blow proved too much for him. Whatever you wish for another, you create and manifest in your own body and experience. Moses and the Egyptian priests. In ancient times, the multitude believed that their priests had the power to curse those who displeased or irritated them, and the priests of that day took advantage of the ignorance of the people. Moses saw through the chicanery and deceit of the Egyptian priests. They were completely dumbfounded by him, and their fear of him caused the priests to abandon their attempts at intimidating Moses and his people. Moses taught the oneness of the spiritual power. The belief and faith of the Egyptians was built on a belief in many powers. Moses knew that God was one, and his awareness scattered all negative ideas to the winds. Become a straight-line thinker. It is absolutely essential that you get this straight, that harmony, beauty, love, peace, joy, and all the blessings of life come from the one source. God cannot do anything unloving, for God is boundless love. God cannot wish pain, for God is absolute peace. God cannot wish sorrow, for God is absolute joy. God cannot wish death, for God is life, and that is your life now. All so-called curses, sorcery, black magic, Satanisms, etc., come from the frightfully ignorant belief in a suppositional opposite force. There is only one power, one God, not two, three, or 1,000, just one. To believe in an evil power to challenge God is based entirely on a rank superstition. When men use the one power constructively, harmoniously, peacefully, and joyously, they call it God. When men use the power ignorantly, negatively, and foolishly, they call it Satan, devil, evil spirits, etc. Curses return home to roost. When you turn to the living Spirit Almighty within you and open your mind and heart and daily affirm, God is, and His presence flows through me as harmony, beauty, love, peace, joy, and abundance. God watches over me, and I am always surrounded by the sacred circle of God's love. And when you give complete allegiance, loyalty, and confidence to the one power within, you are called Israel in the Bible. The Bible says, "Surely there is no enchantment against Jacob, neither is there any divination against Israel." Numbers chapter 23, verse 23. A man who recognizes the supremacy of the Spirit and the power of his own thought will find that all his ways are pleasantness and all his paths are peace.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.